as a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It is a blessing for me to be here this evening for this charge conference that we have called here, and to be in this space. This is where I had my installation service. It has a very special place for me in my heart, and you all do great work here, just really great work, and I want to celebrate that night, that tonight with you all is just the wonderful work that you're doing. You have great pastors and great leadership. And you are moving ahead in a number of different ways, which is really very exciting. So I want to welcome you this evening. We are here to do some business. This is Book of Discipline business. It's business that every year we have to do, like your pastor's pastoral support forms, and they like that because that means they get paid, you know, for the next year. And your nominating lay leadership form. So there's a few things that business items that we have to do. It really does not take very long. And so we're going to do those here in a moment. And then we have a time of learning this evening, and we're using some material from the bishop's newest book, Just Say Yes, unleashing people for ministry. And I like all the bishop's materials, but this one in particular is really good for the local church. I suspect you're going to have to participate a little bit tonight. There's some discussion times. You're going to be kind of in groups, kind of talking through a few basic questions. I think you all already have a lot of it. You're already down the road with it, but I think the conversation is good because it reminds us of how we need to say yes instead of no all the time, and we tend to have a default to say no instead of yes. So we're going to do a little bit of learning time there. So again, it is great to be here this evening, and I will do everything I can to get us out here in about an hour by 8 o'clock, because I know you all have other things to do, and so I'm grateful that you're here. I want to introduce this evening your district lay leader, Susan March. Susan is a member at Wilkes Boulevard in Columbia and does a lot of work there with their homeless ministries, and is really been a great partner for me as I've entered into this new place. I am Sherry Hobbin, by the way. I just realized that some of you may not know who I am. I started in this role the 1st of July, and it has been a blessing. You're one of my last charge conferences. Got a couple more, and I've been all around our district at this point and have talked with almost all of our pastors. And we have some really, really great ministries going on in this district. Our churches are doing really great creative things, and I am blessed by that and very thankful and grateful for that. We also have a lot of challenges, as all of our districts do today, and one of the biggest challenges that I found as I've traveled around is a food deficit, a lack of food that is just prevalent no matter what part of our district that we're in. And we have a very diverse district, from the lakes regions to the kind of university systems and here in Columbia to rural churches that go all the way up north to Saline County around Marshall. And it doesn't matter what area of the district I'm in. There is a growing, prevailing food shortage, especially with children and the elderly, senior citizens, but it's growing for everyone. And the blessing in that, the way that God brings good, is that many of our churches are engaged in some type of food program, either serving breakfast. We've got one little church out here outside of Fayette that actually serves breakfast to about 30 kids now every morning, and they live right across from where they're doing this is right across from the elementary school. So they give the kids food, they play some games with them, and then they actually walk them across to the school on Sunday on every morning, school morning. And so that's a blessing. And we have backpack programs, and we have feeding programs where meals are actually being prepared at different times in food pantries, all kinds of different ministries that are going on, and so we're grateful for that. But we have some very creative, good churches in our district that's doing excellent ministry regardless of the size of the church or the location, so I'm grateful for that. We're going to start with a passage of scripture, and Susan's going to read that passage for us.
So good evening. I just wanted to say hey to you all. And so I'm going to read out of the Message Bible, which is kind of a little different. It's an interpretation of the Bible by Eugene Peterson. And so I kind of picked this up at annual conference down in Springfield a few years back. And I always tell people it's kind of a little weird because it says, like, hey, bro, I'm here. Anyway, it doesn't say that, but it's like that type of language. But anyway, so I find it kind of refreshing. So I think it's always good for whoever's reading the Bible to kind of have a variety. So Sherry and I, we discussed, I've got another one. I've got my study application Bible. And we kind of looked at the passage. I thought, you know, I'll just bring this a big old honker thing, you know. And so I carried it in. And it just didn't fit with our thing tonight. So here we go back to the Message. But anyway, so I'm going to read out of Hebrews. It's Hebrews 11. It starts at verse 8. It says, by an act of faith, Abraham said yes to God's call to travel to an unknown place that would become his home. When he left, he had no idea where he was going. By an act of faith, he lived in the country promised him, lived as a stranger, camping in tents. Isaac and Jacob did the same, living under the same promise. Abraham did it by keeping his eye on an unseen city with real eternal foundations, the city designed and built by God. By faith, barren Sarah was able to become pregnant, old woman as she was at the time, because she believed the one who made a promise would do what he said. That's how it happened that from one man's dead and shriveled loins, there are now people numbering into the millions. Each one of these people of faith died, not yet having in hand what was promised, but still believing. How did they do it?
I love that question. How did they do it? The other versions don't have that question in there, but I think it's a very pertinent question. How did they do it? How did they have the faith to go someplace where they didn't even know where they were going? They weren't sure what they were going to find when they got there. Remember, they had to pull up everything, their tents, their animals, all the people that, I mean, there could be a couple hundred people that were with Abraham and Sarah, and they did that not knowing where they were going or what they were going to find when they got there. And so that always intrigues me, that question, how did they do it? And I, you know, as I've pondered that question, there's three things that I think, there may have been others, but three things that occurred to me. And one was that they had to have faith. They did have to have faith in God, that God was going to do what God promised God would do, that God would fulfill that promise and that God would walk alongside them. So they had to have a lot of faith. And they had to have trust. They had to trust that God was going to do that. I mean, you can have faith in it, but you got to trust also that absolutely God is going to do what God said God would do. But I think there's something else that they had to have and that they hadn't, and that's courage. I believe that they had to have courage. And you know, Maya Angelou says that courage is not something that we're born with. It's something that we gain a step at a time. In other words, you get courageous by being courageous. And it builds and it grows as you take each step of courage. And sometimes those are very small steps of courage each and every day. They're not large, big, courageous things. They're just those small acts of courage every single day. And I would imagine that if I, you know, went around and talked to you all could name a few of those, that some days just getting up in the morning can be a step of courage. Making that small decision is an act of courage. And so you gain courage by being courageous, and that courage grows and grows. And I think that's what Abraham and Sarah and all those who went with them had to have. They had to have faith, they had to have trust, and they had to have courage in order to go someplace that they'd never seen and into a place where they didn't know what they were going to find when they got there. I think that today the church is sometimes in a similar place. We are in between paradigms. I don't think I'm saying anything that anybody doesn't understand. What we've been doing isn't working anymore. And so we're having to try some new and different things, but we're not in a different paradigm. We're in what Richard Rohr calls liminal space, the space in between this place and this place. And it takes a lot of courage to be in this place because we're not sure what the answers are anymore. Used to be that we thought we had the answers. I'm not sure whether we really did or not, but we thought we did. We know now that we don't. We don't have all the answers. And so being in ministry today takes courage. It's a courageous act because it means that you're having to try new things. You're having to step out in faith. You're having to take risks. And part of that risk is a risk of failure. And being okay with that you're going to try this, and if it doesn't work, that's okay. You're going to pick yourself up, and you're going to try something else again. You're going to learn from it and go forward. And so I think that just like Abraham and Sarah and all those who picked up and followed them without knowing, we're in a similar place today. So I think we have to have faith, and we have to have trust, and we have to have courage and take those small steps every single day to move ahead into the place where God is calling us today. And I happen to know that you all in this church are really doing some of that. And so I want to commend that for the wonderful ministries that you have, you know, going on here and the places that you're stepping out and doing some new and different things. I pray for you all the time, and for your pastors, and for Daniel and Keith and Jeannie, and the leadership that they give to this conference, and the ways that they continue to take those sometimes small and sometimes larger steps of courage out there every single day. So I am grateful for that and for all that you do. So I'm going to ask Daniel to open us with prayer here as we get to enter into our business this evening.
Sure. I invite you to please join with me in prayer. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you for your call to step out in faith and for the assurance that we do not take that step alone. The assurance that when we step out in faith, you go with us, and also in our particular part of the family of the body of Christ, we are bound together through this connection that we call the United Methodist Church and the Missouri Annual Conference and the Mid-State District. We thank you for sisters and brothers who journey with us. We thank you for this time together tonight, for the opportunity and joy to be intentional about the ministry that happens here. We pray that you would guide us and be in all we do. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you, Daniel. And I know that you have a stewardship campaign that's been going on. I'm particularly intrigued by the little blue diving backward man, which is an act of courage in and of itself to dive backwards. So, you know, continue on, little blue diving backward man, or whether I said that right, yeah. So. That's awesome. Awesome. All right. So we're gonna get our business done here. You all should have a packet that's in front of you that looks like this. And so we're going to be referring to that as we go through here this evening. And the first thing that we're going to vote on is your election of officers for this next year. And you should have that in front of you. It's also lay leadership. There's a number of different names for it. But it is all your people who are going to be serving on teams, boards, and committees here for the next year. So I'd like for you to get that out and kind of take a look at that. And while you're doing that, we'll also say that, you know, any vacancy, we vote here, but any vacancy that you all have during the year, and those come up all the time, you don't have to call another church conference to take care of. Your council or board can fill those vacancies in between. But tonight we're voting on what you have in front of you. So are there any questions? You all probably have seen this already. Are there any questions before we vote? All right, seeing no questions, all those that are in favor of your election of officers sheet, if you would raise your hands. Are there any opposed? All right, see how easy that is? That one's taken care of. All right, the next thing we're going to vote for is the pastoral support form, but before we do that, I don't want to miss this opportunity. I almost missed right over it there. So I would like to just stop here for a moment. Any of you that, and I imagine a lot of you are in leadership, but I want to say a prayer for those that we just voted on. And if you're here, if you will stand up, or if you serve in any capacity here in the church, I'd like for you to stand up this evening. We couldn't run the church without you all. And I want to say a word of thanks and gratitude for those that are here and those that are not here, for the work that you do. You all have day jobs and other things that occupy your time, and yet you agree to serve further for the church in many different ways. So if you're here tonight, if you would stand up. Always takes a minute. It's like they're hesitant to stand up and be thanked, you know. Thank you. I am very grateful for all of you, and I want to say a word of prayer this evening. Loving and gracious God, you have called these your laity into these positions of service, many different positions that they do for the church, the ministries that they do, and we are indeed thankful for them. I ask blessings on the gifts that you have given to them, on the ways that they use those gifts. I ask blessings on their families And on this congregation, Lord, so many gifts that are here that they willingly use to reach out and to make disciples for you and to do service and ministry in this community and beyond. We are grateful for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. All right, the next thing we're going to vote on is the pastoral support package. This is a package. This is your pastor's salary for this next year. There's also some other documents that are there, accountable reimbursement policy, housing furnishing allowance, several other pieces. And so it's a packet of information. So if you would take a look at that, and there are three packets that you all have, one for Daniel, one for Keith, and one for Jeannie. So if you would take a look at those, and let me know if there are any questions that you have on any of those three pastoral support forms.
On Daniel's residence.
Pardon?
On Daniel's residence. I was wondering if this is correct.
I apparently forgot to put the address in. I'm sorry.
Oh, you didn't put the address? Okay. We will get the address filled in.
We're keeping it secret.
You're keeping it secret? Okay. Yeah, you know where he lives. There you go. That's okay. We didn't catch that. We will get that filled in. Any other questions? Yes.
This one where it says under the agreement that $12,360, this reduction in annual compensation, what does that mean? Twice a month. I don't know what that means.
Is that the
Right. That's insurance for my family.
Okay.
And so, for it's considered the premium for that is considered part of my salary, but I never see it. So it's like it's reduced before it's put in my paycheck. And so that's what that is. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for asking.
Good question.
Yeah.
Any other questions on any of the three? All right. Seeing no other questions. If you are in favor of all three pastoral support packages, if you will raise your hands. Any opposed? All right, pastors, you get paid for another year. That's a good thing. And I would like our pastors to stand up, if they would, for a moment. You know, as I said, doing ministry today is not easy. It has not been an easy week, two or three weeks in our world, in our state, in our world. There are just so many different things going on, a lot of tension and anxiety and issues that have to be dealt with and confronted, and the church has to figure out today what to do with. One of those is a Syrian refugee piece, and Daniel has stepped into that and is doing great leadership there. But it is not easy to be a pastor today. And your three pastors are doing an excellent job and are stepping out, taking risks, doing great leadership. So I want us to realize that tonight. I want to commend all of them and the work that they do and the difficulty that it can be to do ministry. A blessing also, but a lot of issues that have arisen in our world in the last few weeks that cause a lot of consternation as to how to handle and what to do with and how to best do ministry in those settings. So what I'd like to do, I'd like for you all just to kind of put your hands out towards your pastors, and I'm going to say a prayer this evening. Oh Lord, you have called these pastors, they are your pastors, that you have called and called into this place. And we are thankful for them and grateful for them. You have given them so many gifts, and they use those gifts willingly on your behalf to make disciples. And Lord, so we ask your blessings. We ask your encouragement and your strength that you might hold them up and lift them up and give them wisdom and give them discernment in these difficult times to know the words to say, the actions to take. Give them courage to be willing to step out in the places that you call them to say what needs to be said, to do what needs to be done. We ask blessings on them, on their families who work with them. There are families that that often are involved in so many different ways also. I ask blessings on their congregation, this congregation. Lord, just continue to walk with them. Continue to be the one that whispers those encouragements in their ear, that gives them continued strength to do the ministry you call them to do. We are grateful and thankful for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, in your packet there is a report of the trustees that has been submitted. We do not vote on this report, but I always suggest that you take a look at it. It tells you what your trustees have done over the course of the year. They're often very active, sometimes behind the scenes, and sometimes people don't realize everything that they do. A lot of building maintenance and outdoor maintenance and insurance pieces, and sometimes the Safe Sanctuary pieces, just a number of different places where...
I didn't hand out that.
Oh, you didn't hand out that? Well, then you don't have it in your packet. Okay. No, just know that your trustees do a lot of work, and there is a report that they have turned in. And so we just want to say a word of thanks to them tonight for the work that they do. The next thing is a care of members report that is in the packet. And we do not vote on this tonight because you don't have any names to be read. The only time we vote is if you are reading names, and when you read names, that means that you've done an audit of your membership, and people who have not attended in a period of time, they try to reach them by phone and by cards and a number of different ways and locate them to see if they want to remain on the rolls. And so each time the audit is done, sometimes there are names to be read. They have to be read 2 years, so there's a first year reading and a second year reading, but you all don't have any of those, so we don't have that to vote on tonight. Also in that report are lists of people who have come in, that have joined the congregation, and lists of people who are no longer with us due to a number of different reasons. And so I always stop here. One of the greatest gifts that God gives to us is the gift of people and relationships. And all of these people that are among us, they affect our lives. They work with us, they teach us, they minister to us, and that's a great gift. So I want to stop and say a word of prayer. And for each of you to just, you know, take a look at that list, some of those people that are on that list, the ones that have come in and the ones that are no longer with us, may have affected your life. And so let us take a moment to acknowledge those relationships. Oh, Lord, we are grateful tonight for people, for the relationships that you give to us, that affect us in so many different ways. And so for those who are no longer with us, we are grateful for the time that we had with them, for the ways that they engaged in this congregation, and indeed more personally in some of our lives in many different ways. And so we give thanks for them. We are particularly grateful tonight for all the new folks that have come into our midst. we ask tonight that you might help us to make sure that we're making space for those new folks and for the new ideas that they bring. They bring fresh eyes and different perspectives that can help us, Lord, become more of the church that you want us to be. So we're thankful for them tonight, and again, we're thankful for people and for the relationships that you give to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. We have one more thing to vote on, and that is every year those that are certified lay servants have to be approved one more time. And so we have a request from Madeline Green, who is one of your certified lay servants, for this church conference to approve her for another year. Are there any questions on any of that? Okay, all those in favor of certifying Madeline for another year, if you'll raise your hands. Anybody opposed? All right. Folks, we're done with the business. See that, how easy that is. Woohoo! And again, I just want to celebrate. I want to celebrate the ministries that you all are doing, and I hope that you are finding ways to celebrate that also, because it is a great gift to you and to us, and we're thankful for that. So now we're going to go to the learning time, and we're going to go to that slide that has the statement on it, the next one. That's it. The premise, the basic premise of the book and the conversation that we're going to have is that growing churches say yes to things that declining congregations say no to. And so it's a matter of whether we say yes or no. And those congregations that are finding ways to say yes, taking the risks, moving into new places, are the ones that are growing. And the congregations that continue to say no are the congregations that are declining. So we're going to watch a short video here that starts out with Bishop Schnazy, and then two of our pastors, Jen Klein, who's in the Kansas City area, and Jim Downing, who's at Sedalia First, are going to talk a little bit about that.
Just Say Yes is written for the person who's been yearning to be set free to do more ministry. I've just noticed in my work with churches that so many churches, the default is no. People say no to people, pastors say no to laity say no to pastors, traditional worshipers say no to contemporary worshipers. And then they have systems in the churches that say no, unintentionally. Some churches are structured in a way that if somebody has a good idea, they've got to take it to 5 or 7 different committees or people to get permission. And any one of them can say no and close it down, but none of them have the authority to say yes. And so there's 1,000 ways that churches say no. And so I wanted to just draw attention to that and talk about how do you develop a culture of yes. Because growing churches say yes to things that declining churches say no to. And pastors that lead growing churches tend to say yes to things that pastors of declining churches tend to say no to. So I'm trying to just change that default from no to yes.
The idea of Just Say Yes is a systematic way by which you can take individuals and a group of persons to really explore and listen and to faithfully give your yes in ways that selfless and more focused in on where God might be leading. And that's a hard thing to do. We can let our own personal agendas get in the way. Good intended, but it may not be God intended. And a lot of the time it's fear that creates the resistance. Fear to the unknown, fear to change, fear to doing things the way we haven't done it before, when really that's where God is probably doing God's work, is in the midst of that. And our invitation to the yes is to step into the midst of that and be okay.
God has a plan for us. It's for good, not for evil, to give us a future and a hope. A lot of people believe there's a future. They just think the future is going to be just as rotten and terrible as today. But we're trying to cast a vision, joining and partnering with God, that God's idea is that God wants to bring good to our life and to always offer hope. The rails that I see most churches running on are, we've always done it this way, and that limits us to our past. We talk about in an old hymn, "Oh God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come." It's not simply dwelling on the past, which is what history does, but a heritage that says, God who was with us then is the God who's with us now, and the one who will be with us in the days, years to come. And we're not going to run on the other rail, which is we've never done it that way before. And so that is where fear comes in, because we're saying, I'm too afraid to try. And most of it's because we're afraid we're gonna fail. Well, let's get over it. We're going to fail, but we don't have to have a final failure. We can live, learn, move through that failure, move towards some successes in God.
I hope that this book really does have the effect of unleashing people for ministry. I thought about other titles, Just Say Yes, Becoming a Permission-Giving Church, or Encouraging People in Ministry. But I finally landed on that word unleashing, because I think it captures this pent-up energy and yearning on people's hearts to make a difference and to serve God and to serve their neighbors. And how they have felt restrained and held back. And so I have a hope that this has that that feel of letting people loose and giving them that kind of permission. And that would be my highest hope for this book, is that when leaders sit down, they reflect on their own behaviors. They look at their systems. They look at the unmet needs around them, the people who are feeling called to express their ministries, that they'll unleash a whole new spirit in the congregation.
Okay, we're going to go to the next slide. And there are some questions there. Well, there's a quote. When we set people, that's good. Thank you, Paul. When we set people free to do the work of God, the Spirit of Christ propels us into places and into ministries we could never have imagined. Have any of you been there? I see some heads nodding, and all the pastors' heads I know are nodding. I've been there. We've all been there in places that we never, ever could imagine. And sometimes it's in our jobs. Sometimes it's in our ministries. And we're not quite sure sometimes how we got there and why we're there sometimes. But that's what happens when we set people free and when people are able to open their hearts to the work of the Spirit. So we're going to go now to the next slide with the questions. And I want you all in small groups to spend a little bit of time talking through these questions. Where do ideas come from in your ministry setting? In other words, where you have an idea that somebody has brought to you, and it comes from a number of different places. Where do those come from in your ministry setting? And can you map the path from the time you hear the idea to it actually becoming a ministry? What has to happen to it from the time that the idea comes about to it actually becoming a ministry? And what forms of resistance do ministry ideas face in your setting? Why do we say no? Why do we say no? So take a few moments and talk a little bit around some of that, and we'll come back together and talk. I'd like to just talk for just a moment about some of what you discussed. I saw some, heard some really good conversations going on. So just kind of yell it out. Where do ministry ideas come from here in your setting? Conversations in the congregation. Okay, that certainly is the case. Where else?
Church staff.
Are there other places you might get ideas? What about folks outside the congregation? Mm-hmm. Sometimes. It's from the community, but it's not that they're knocking on your door and saying, hey, I have an idea for you. Sometimes they do, but not always. We have a wonderful program called Mission Insight, which is an online program that our pastors have access to that has all kinds of demographic pieces. And sometimes it's in looking at who's around you that it does speak an idea into your midst. So if you're in an area where there's a large number of single moms, that lends itself to a number of different ideas for ministry that might be there. So sometimes if you're studying and being attentive to who's around you, then ideas are going to come from that. And in one of the first charge conferences that I did, somebody in the back of the room said, from the Holy Spirit. And I said, absolutely, ideas come from the Holy Spirit. And I said, and sometimes we say no to the Holy Spirit for reasons of our own, because I do believe that God works through people and God gives ideas to people, and I trust that that is happening. And because of our own issues or resistances, we say no to those ideas and shut those down. So the ideas come from a number of different places. So what happens once the idea's in the midst? What happens to that idea before it can actually become a ministry in the name of this church? Okay, so there's a staff person that deals with that area. All right, what else has to happen to it? Once a staff person has heard the idea, are there other places that it has to go here? Okay, so a kind of a support team, a group that has to kind of take a look at it. Okay, any place else? Sometimes, if it has financial ramifications.
Really big.
Okay, yeah, right. And so sometimes it has to go to a group for financial approval. Sometimes it has to go to a group, maybe there's a mission team or something if it's a mission idea. But the point is that in a number of places, there's this whole system and structure that that an idea has to go through first before it can become an idea. And in the book, the bishop gives several examples, but one in particular was of a young woman, and I believe this was a true example, who it was after a natural disaster, and she had an idea as to how to respond to that, and she came, you know, to the pastor, and the pastor, you know, said, well, that needs to go to our ad board, and they meet next month. And it got to the ad board. You're already shaking your head. You already know where I'm going here. Got to the ad board, and it did have some financial ramifications. And so they said it's got to go to the finance committee, and they meet in 2 months. And the end result was that by the time that she actually got the approval to do the ministry that she needed to do and that was timely, the need was gone. It had passed, and she left the church because God had laid an idea on her heart, and it had gotten caught in sometimes our structure and our system. So what forms of resistance do ministry ideas face? Why do we say no? Those are the top two. That's right. Money or people. Don't have enough money, don't have enough people. Are there others? Pardon? Fear. Yeah, that's fear. And that fear takes a number of different forms, where fear of failure is, as Jim Downing said, and so we just choose not to do it. We've all never done it that way before, or sometimes even worse, we've done it that way before and it didn't work, so we're not going to go there again. And then there's one that I believe is prevalent in a number of places, And that is called defensiveness and territoriality. And in some places, you have ministries that have been in place, and they've done good work. I mean, they've been good, fruitful ministries up to a certain point. Culture changes, churches change, the people in churches change, the needs change, and all of a sudden, that ministry is not doing, it's not being effective and fruitful anymore. And yet, you know, if anything, we United Methodists are nice and kind people. And we don't want to upset anybody sometimes, and we don't want to certainly cause conflict. And so, and people can get tied up in their ministries and become defensive and territorial about those ministries. And so rather than cause problems or cause upset, we leave those ministries in place for fear of hurting feelings or causing conflict. And as long as those are in place, new ideas and new resources can't be used to do that. So there's a number of different reasons why we say no and why there's resistance. Let's go to the next slide, Paul. Thank you. This talks about behaviors and qualities that it takes in a system to be permission giving. Basically, what we're talking about is permission giving ministry, saying yes instead of no. Now, I will say that there is a section in the book, there are times when it's appropriate to say no, that it isn't the right time, or the ministry is not going to work, and so there are places where it is okay to say no, but we want the default to be yes instead of no. And so the question here, and I'm not going to have you discuss tonight, I'm going to give you some of the answers for time's sake, and this one can be a little more difficult for people to get their heads around a little bit anyway. But all of you are leaders here, you would not be here. And so what is it that you need to have in order to be a permission-giving leader and to lead in a permission-giving culture? And so these are just a few. They're in the bishop's book on page 96. And first and foremost, they have to have trust. It's part of what we were talking about earlier. They have to have confidence that most people love Christ, desire the best for the church, and operate with the highest of motives, and believe that people have capacities and gifts for ministry. And along with that, they have to believe that God does work through people, and that God gives them what they need to do the work they're called to do. They trust that God is at work in people. They're initiators. They're folks that think outside the box. They shift from saying you ought to saying I will. Often what happens is somebody comes into a church and they say, church, you ought to do this. This is a great idea, and church, you need to take it on. And then they walk out the door. And so the shift from you ought to I will is not somebody coming in and putting the ministry in the middle of the table and saying you ought to do this, but coming in and saying I would like to do this. And so there's a subtle and not so subtle shift there in the ways that a permission-giving person operates. They're responsible risk takers, with the key being responsible. There are times to say no, but they're willing to take the risks, and they're willing to fail, those permission-giving leaders. They know how to listen. I think that's a very important quality. They know how to listen, are willing to listen, and take the time to listen. And as I said before, they operate with a minimum of defensiveness and territoriality. And they get out of the way. They get out of the way, and they allow things to happen. And so what does all this mean? What is this leading to? And there's three examples, I believe, in the book of permission-giving ministries that have been operating here in the state of Missouri. And one is Jim Downing's church. Their motto is say yes. But the one I'm going to talk about tonight is Woods Chapel United Methodist in Lee's Summit. And that's because I did ministry not too far from there and worked with their church and sat in on some of their processes as they were first beginning. They've done this now for about 15 years or so. Their version of, like, their ad board is called the Dream Team. Now, Jeff would say that that's not his favorite name, but you know it's worked for the last 15 years or so, so I don't think he's going to change it. And one of the resources, you have several resources that are available to you, and I hope you got the, you're kind of past the date on the ordering the books, but we sent an email, so okay. We have several resources that have been made available to you all of our churches, and one is to order books at a reduced price, but there's also several videos, and one of the videos is Jeff Brinkman, who's the senior pastor at Woods Chapel, and telling how they kind of got started with this. But basically, this is how it works. And I went and sat at one of their Dream Team meetings one night, and it was just quite fascinating. They have reports, and they have stuff they have to vote on and do, but the primary part is dreaming about ministry. And so when somebody comes with an idea, they do have a staff person that handles whatever area it might be in. And they ask the person three questions. They have to be able to answer three questions. One is, does it fit with the mission and vision of the church? So whatever that stated vision is it going to help the church accomplish its mission and vision? The second question is, do they have somebody lead it? And the third question is, can they fund it? So that takes care of all the major resistances that we have. And if it fits with those three questions, they can answer those three questions, then they say, go forth and do ministry in our time and our name and be blessed. And that is how they've grown their church. They're a large church, but they become large in part because of their permission-giving ministry format. And what that does is it takes people who have a passion and an idea, and they have funding, and often that funding is coming outside of the church with their friends and colleagues and neighbors, and the people that do the ministry come from those same places also. So the night that I was there, as I recall, somebody was wanting to do a golf tournament to provide funds for a charitable organization that the church endorsed. And so they could answer all those questions, and they said, go do it. And so the person that you know, they said yes to was using their friends outside the church, funds outside the church, and it fit with the mission and vision and helped promote that. And so what that does is it puts, and they also had people from within the church. So people within the church are working with the people outside the church, forming relationship, and they got many members and attenders to come into the church that way. And so over the years, that has affected, you know, how they've grown. So that's one model. There's some other models that are in there. There are other videos that are available to you, case studies of churches here in the state of Missouri. One of those is a little church in Sturgeon, Missouri. Small church. I mean, they were down to a very small number of folks, maybe 20. Not sure how long they were going to be able to stay open. And there was a great need in that area for food. And so over the course of time and working ecumenically, the pastor there eventually put in a food pantry and a program there. Here about 2 months ago, the pastor won the Man of the Year award in Sturgeon, Missouri from the city for the work that he had done, and they're now feeding, the last I heard was 700 people a week there. Yeah, I mean, it's just an amazing thing, and this little congregation, but by working with their community, they were able to do some really great ministry by saying yes. Basically, they said yes, we're willing to take the risk, we're willing to work with it. So as I said earlier, I think that you all are way down the road there in the ways that you say yes and in the ministries that you do. So we're grateful for that. The church today has got to figure out ways to say yes in places that sometimes we would have said no, and to take the risks that need to be taken to do the ministry that God is calling us to in this time and in this place, which is a different place than where we've been before, and it's going to take a different type of ministry. So I am grateful for all of you, and we're now going to close with a couple of songs this evening. Songs of worship and gratitude and praise.
All right, if you would turn to your hymnals, those of you that have a hymnal nearby. If you don't, Daniel can pass some back. Oh, good, okay. Well, see, I'm not used to that, so here I am. Oh.
sea and sky. I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go. Speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord. If you set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am. treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Amen.
I also just want to say a word of thanks to all of you for being here tonight. We know that It is always busy for everyone, and we appreciate your taking the time, your love for the church and Christ that brings you here tonight. A word of thanks to James and Sherry for special music this evening. We're grateful to God for them. Thank you so much to people working behind the scenes to make this possible, like Mary Lynn, who's taking notes, which we appreciate, and Keith, who worked really hard to get all of our forms ready, and Jerry, who is also a huge part of that. And way in the back, Paul running our audio video. Susan, thank you for being here tonight and for reading scripture. We're grateful for you. And thanks especially to Reverend Sherry Hobbin for leading us. Sherry has a wonderful love for Christ, for the conference, and for local churches, and they all shine through great. And so we're so grateful for her. You know, Sherry's been praying for all of us tonight. Can we say a quick prayer for Sherry? Let's pray. Oh, God, thank you for Sherry and for her ministry to our church and to our district as our district superintendent. You have carried her through many church conferences already, and we're grateful that as each brings joy, we're also grateful for an end in sight for her, too. Thank you for all the ways that she encourages us and helps us to learn to say yes for the ministry of Jesus Christ in our community. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
I want to say another word of thanks to all of you, and I really love the image. I want you to leave tonight with the image of that little blue diving backward man. And I'm serious about that because it takes a lot of courage to dive backwards, and so I'm it's stuck in my mind there, and I think that's what it takes today is the courage to sometimes dive backwards into new places, and so you all are on the right track. And I just send you forth this evening in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen.